I mean, the earliest memories I have of being on a motorcycle was when my dad used to take me to school. He had a two-stroke Yamaha RD350 at that time. I mean, even today, compared to the everyday motorcycle, that was a zippy bike. It had a whole lot of juice in it. A widowmaker, if you want to call it that. So I remember the vibrations and sitting on the gas tank, just holding onto the handlebar. You know, that's where it all started, I guess. We're finding a connect with the bike. And then he later taught me how to ride a motorcycle when I was about 7 years old. And that was a BSA 50cc, a Falcon. And we used to go to the motocross track and he taught me in the dirt. So I guess that's where it all started. I actually cultivated a love for bikes and it's just, you know, grown a few fold over the years. My name is Vijay Singh. I run Rajputana Custom Motorcycles. We are based in Jaipur, Rajasthan, India. The city was like a racetrack, to be honest. Growing up in Jaipur, it wasn't so developed back in the day. But it's one of the oldest, architecturally, it's one of the first planned cities in the country. So in the 1800s, so we had great roads, super broad and whatnot. Obviously, no runoff area. You had a curb on the side if you messed up. It was just awesome to ride because there was no traffic post 9, 10 o'clock at night. And unfortunately, over the years, it just got so populated that, you know, we can't have too much fun out in the streets. I mean, it's 3-4 million, I think, now. So it's just been an urban sprawl. I miss the days when, you know, times were simpler and you knew which kids were on which block around which corner and which guys you could speak to. And, you know, everybody was identifiable. Now I feel like an alien in my own city. But at the same time, we have tracks in New Delhi and a motocross track around the city that you can still go to. So that's still there. But I miss riding around in the street and enjoying the city for what it is. The riding culture in Jaipur, I mean, essentially is, the two-wheeler population is huge, it's humongous. So a lot of it is commuters, you know, it's not really people, I mean, it's people who are going to work, just getting through their day. So a motorcycle is very convenient through traffic. And, you know, if you come to Jaipur, you'd see probably 3 to 4 people on a bike, even if it's a family. And that's how people get around, you know, much like the rest of Southeast Asia. Harleys have always been like I wouldn't say the forbidden fruit, but it's been always out of reach for people because we've been admiring them. You've seen them in the movies, you know. So finally, when I got to ride my first Harley was in 2009. And, you know, I didn't know what I was in for. And the people around in the city didn't know what they were in for when I was on a Harley. But we've been lucky that, you know, with the coming of all these big manufacturers like Harley-Davidson and whatnot. So we've got that experience that the first world has, and you know, India has a great love for motorcycles, and it's just been beautiful to have these bikes that we can buy and enjoy. And even if we don't ride them in the city, we've got excellent expanses on the highway, so you can do a lot of riding, you know, all across the country, and it's these bikes are just great. I had finished university in Canada. I was there for about 4 years doing journalism and mass media. So I finished that up in 2009, and that's when I came back home. And before I actually started up a job working for Sports Center in Bombay, thought I'd take on a summer project and try and build myself a bike. I thought I'd bitten off more than I can chew, and that's exactly what had happened. But I had great help from metal fabricators and ex-racers in the city. None of these guys had actually built a bike before. So, you know, I did a little bit of the theoretical research, went online. The internet was an immense help, and it still is today. You know, I researched my materials, I researched the motorcycle dynamics, and then we went about metal fabricating the whole bike. We used a Royal Enfield was my first motorcycle to start, but that's what kicked it all off. And it was, like I said, it was a very eventful learning process. We went wrong 9 times out of 10. But that taught us everything that we know. And looking back in hindsight, you know, big problems that seemed, you know, like mountains are common knowledge today. And so that's been a reassuring fact that you just got to take one step at a time, put one foot in front of the other and keep moving forward. And, you know, every expert was a beginner once. Every profession was an amateur at some point. So India had a caste system, which... isn't prevalent. I mean, it is prevalent today as well, I guess, to a certain extent, but it was abolished quite some time back. And you have the priesthood, which is the highest up there. Then you have the warrior caste, and then the businessmen and the workers and whatnot. So the Rajputs were the warrior caste, and it was our segment of society based on our last name. We were supposed to send our sons and our family members. I mean, all the men went to the army to serve and protect. We have a lineage of that. Rajasthan was full of these Rajputs, and we had a lot of warring clans. And after the British came here, they kind of divided us, ruled us, and then unified all of us put together. And we, being from Rajasthan, and our bikes have that influence of, you know, my design sense of, you know, the heritage and culture and art and music that I've been influenced by over the years while growing up. So, you know, and our bikes represent that, whether it's the Koftkari design you see, or the silver inlay, or the Jawaja leatherwork, you know, so you see a reflection of Rajasthan in some of our bikes. We don't necessarily embellish all of our motorcycles, but when called for, you can definitely say that this is a Rajputana custom when you look at it. I started the shop in on Feb 2nd, 2010, but I was building bikes. I was building my first bike before that, a few months before that. When I first started, it was the gardener's son who used to help me out. He was out of a job and he was just floating around in his boxers and he didn't know what to do. So I sent him to the market to go and buy me some stuff, and that's how he joined me. Then we had a metal fabricator who was an ex-ray. My dad's mechanic fellow racer's son, Abdul. So it was Abdul, Tapan and me to start with. And then over the years, we've had more and more people join us. You know, when we first started doing this, people didn't even know what customization was, so to speak. And when they saw our work, they used to ask us, why is it so expensive? Or what sense does this make? Or why would people buy your bikes, even if it was my own family? Let alone me do something, it was hard to build a team. It was hard to build this business. Or this way of life, if you want to call it that. It's not much of a business. We try and make do with what we get. And as long as the shop is running, we're happy. But now we have about 16, 18 employees. And we have excellent metal fabricators. We have a great lathe machinist. We have good experienced painters in there. And every intern that comes to us has a strong will to learn. And they're really hardworking boys. And, you know, everybody keeps the shop afloat. When we teach bike building, essentially, it's a 7-day course. So we have students come in. They're usually design and engineering students. So all of these guys are either pursuing a master's degree or an undergraduate degree. Some of them have already cleared school and they haven't been able to land jobs because India creates so many engineers and designers and, you know, name it. But there's not enough in the automobile industry out there with major manufacturers for everybody to get a job. So they, and you know, even for them to grow and do something of their own, they need practical experience. So RCM is one of the few shops in the country that actually gives them an A to Z, you know, like right from an ideation of a design to the execution and the final finish of a motorcycle being photographed. So whether you're using various softwares to design, the motorcycle on a computer, or you're using a pen and paper and doing graphs or templates or, you know, just ideating certain handlebars and the stance of a motorcycle. So right from there to learning the fabrication process, learning how power tools work, how your basic tools work. I mean, when these kids first come into the shop, we run them through the safety. We tell them that this work takes a lot of hard work. You can't be sitting on your backside and imagine a bike is going to take shape itself. It takes a lot of people coming together and putting in the time to actually build a bike from scratch or to even customize a bike halfway. So we try and give them a sense of what it takes to either set up a shop or to build bikes, and how much of a reward it has in the end, whether it's financial or self-satisfaction. So, you know, when they come here, they get, I mean, we try and open up our hearts and our minds to them, I mean, as much as we can. And we try and give them, because we know it takes a lot, you know, and it takes a whole lot out of you. So if you don't love this work, you won't be able to sustain yourself and you won't be able to do it for too long. What I've come to learn over the years is that motorcycles are the cure. I've said that before, you know, whether I've had a bad day or a big problem, if I can actually jump on that bike or, you know, just go for a short spin, it could be an easy ride. It really does wonders to my state of mind. The more involved I got with bikes, the more found that, you know, I have a deep affection for them. So it's just, I mean, I don't know how to put it, but it's been a very self-fulfilling, productive avenue of my life. It's not work per se. It's not very casual. It's not laid back. It's something I can indulge in. It's something that I like putting my energies into and working hard at.